Good morning, everybody, and good afternoon and good evening to those who are not watching in the United States. And we thank all of our speakers and our audience in Kyrgyzstan. We know it's evening there. My name is Paul Stronsky. I'm a senior fellow in the Carnegie Endowment's Washington, D.C. based Russia and Eurasia program, where I cover the Central Asia, the Caucasus, and Russia's relationship and China's relationship with this broad region. We're very pleased to have all of you here today for a very important discussion on the referendum in Kyrgyzstan that is coming up just in a few days. This has been a large part. Kyrgyzstan has had a very tumultuous past year. It's experienced sort of the COVID pandemic, the economic crisis, and then a series of political shocks starting last fall. And this is sort of the latest iteration. And we at Carnegie have been trying to follow this and keep these issues in the front and center of the American audience. But also, I would like to say we've had a growing audience as well. In Europe, in Canada, in Central Asia, and even in China itself. And so I expect we have viewers from all of those places here today. This event is being held in partnership with Radio Free Europe and Radio Liberty. And we're pleased to once again have them as a co-host. And as I said, you know, it's been a really intense year in Kyrgyzstan. There's been a lot of votes, a lot of elections, and we have a very resilient public who is putting up with all of this. And today we have three guests with us right now who are going to help us make sense of everything that's going on, what this referendum means for Kyrgyzstan, and then also, you know, what it means in the trajectory of Kyrgyzstan's political future. And with that, I'd like to introduce our first three speakers. We have Venera Jumatayeva, who is the director of the RFERL's Kyrgyz service. She covers major events on Kyrgyzstan, Central Asia, and other international issues, particularly those that touch on the region. She's been a frequent guest here on our events at Carnegie on Central Asia. We have Dr. Sania Toktogazieva, who is an associate professor and coordinator of the Human Rights Program at the American University of Central Asia in Bishkek. She teaches courses on constitutional law, European international criminal law, and human rights law, and holds advanced degrees from Central European University in Budapest. And then we have Natalia Nikitenko, who's a member of the Kyrgyz Parliament, and a deputy chair of the opposition party, Ata Meken. After our first four speakers go, we will then bring in also Adil Basalov, who is the Kyrgyzstan's ambassador to the United Kingdom, and I will give him a proper introduction at that point. So if we could please turn to Venera, that would be great if we could get you started off on where this referendum you know, sits in the broad scope of what's been happening in Kyrgyzstan politics, and how important it is, and where do you think this is going to go?
Hi, everybody. Very nice to see you, Natalia, Sania, and Paul, and everybody. So, Kyrgyzstan is a unique country in Central Asia in many ways. It has its number 6 president now, number 34 prime minister in less than 30 years. And it has no problem to declare that only 39% of the eligible voters cast their ballots in the latest presidential election in January this year. In other countries in the region, in neighboring countries, and in Russia, as you know, presidents almost don't leave and prime ministers don't change that often. And the turnout in elections and referendums are reported as being very high. But changing presidents and prime ministers is not enough. So we in Kyrgyzstan also change constitutions, but fail often. Change doesn't always mean progressive step, but in Kyrgyzstan, it also shows political inconsistency, lack of respect, and even denial of what has already been achieved. So people in Kyrgyzstan already got used to that, to the fact that every new president wants to change the constitution. Or as now current authorities claim, even offer a new edition of the constitution. big change, huge change. This Sunday, Kyrgyzstan will hold its 10th referendum to change the constitution. Almost every new change meant more power to president, including the upcoming one, except for 2010 referendum, when back then interim government, which took power after the April Revolution, ousting former president Bakiyev's regime, declared that they will build a parliamentary democracy. Unfortunately, most of their plans and promises were not realized, including building a real parliamentary system. Instead, leading political parties realized, started serving as platforms for political and economic elites to compete for access to power and resources. Journalists started using a term political corruption to describe how parties were trading parliamentary mandates, bringing as many new candidates as possible to satisfy their mostly unqualified candidates' ambitions. I say unqualified candidates because in 2020 parliamentary elections, we journalists calculated that 221 out of 1,900 candidates on party lists had criminal records. While there is no doubt that court judgments in Kyrgyzstan are politically motivated, there is also strong evidence of links between crime and politics. Semi-parliamentary system declared after 2010 referendum was definitely a big step towards strengthening democracy. But political corruption made current and previous parliaments almost paralyzed and totally dependent on two former presidents, Atambayev and Jeenbekov's administrations. People became very disappointed and frustrated by political instability tied with economic decline or stagnation. And that's why some 81% of out of 31% of eligible voters this January said yes to bringing back the presidential system. With still pretty strong state-controlled media and well-orchestrated trolls army on social media, it is very easy now, not only in Kyrgyzstan, elsewhere also, to convince people that a strong man or powerful president can fix all problems and improve their lives and bring political stability and economic prosperity. Unfortunately, that's what is happening in Kyrgyzstan. But International Republican Institute's last survey published last week became a little surprise for us, where it says that some 70% of people in Kyrgyzstan believe that democracy is the right direction for the country's future. But will this 70% of people, let's say progressive people, vote in Sunday elections and Sunday referendum? Most likely they will not. Because as I said, many, many people are very disappointed. They feel political apathy or indifference, which could result in a record low turnout in this Sunday's referendum. But since it will be tied together with local elections, which is more interesting topic for general public, we might observe enough support for this new edition of constitution. Will it bring political stability and economic development as it is being promised by current authorities? Many people have doubts, so do I. Let's see and now hear from other speakers, and I will join other discussions and answer other questions later on. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, if we could go to Sania, please.
Okay, thank you. Greetings to everyone. It is very nice to see you. Thank you a lot for inviting me for this event. So I want to mostly concentrate on the upcoming constitutional referendum from the legal point of view. And I think it is important to highlight that constitution is the basic law, and it is a social contract between individuals, citizens, and the state. And the constitution must have the highest legal force, or what we call the lawyers, there must be the supremacy of the constitution. So, and any country and government which declares itself a democratic state governed by the rule of law, they must refrain from imposing the constitution. The constitution must be agreed upon. It must not be imposed. Constitution must unite people, not divide people. It must reflect a societal compromise. And actually, and it should work for the interest of the people, not for the interest of the small group of people. And constitution, most importantly, must have the highest form of legitimacy. And any legitimacy of the constitution actually starts with the strict adherence and compliance with the procedure of adoption of the constitution. What we observe right now in Kyrgyzstan is it's the clear demonstration of the fact that the draft text of the constitution absolutely lacks that, not only the highest level of legitimacy, but even the minimum form of legitimacy. Since the way how it was adopted with the gross violations by bypassing all the established stages of the legislative process and the constitution making. And I think it is very important to highlight that, because if we really want, as the final product, the constitution which later on will really be agreed upon and actually accepted by the people, it must have the legitimacy. And the legitimacy, it's not only about the substance, it's actually about the rule of law, is about when the laws are adopted according, following the strictly written rules in the constitution. So what do we have? What kind of violations do we have? First and foremost, the current sixth convocation of our parliament, or Jogorku Kengesh, was not empowered to initiate amendments to the constitution of the Kyrgyz Republic at all. Because after October 28, Jogorku Kengesh sixth convocation, it was forced to continue working in order just to prevent a power vacuum. But this convocation no longer had the right to use its power for fundamental and extraordinary measures like constitutional referendum. And this has been confirmed by the Venice Commission in their urgent opinion amicus curiae, which is very important to highlight that it was requested by the Constitutional Chamber judges themselves. Venice Commission never does their jobs like voluntarily. It is always upon the request of the official governmental bodies. And this is what they did. So they have confirmed it by stating that during the prorogation period, like what we have now in Kyrgyzstan, the parliament in such circumstances, the Jogorku Kengesh, in case of an extra constitutional extension of the period, they cannot approve emergency measures like constitutional referendum. But despite this fact, Jogorku Kengesh went ahead and they have adopted absolutely unconstitutional law on October 22nd by doing three fundamental gross violations. First, they have suspended parliamentary elections that we were supposed to have on December. This was the main demand of the people in October, to have re-elections of the parliament. The people never demanded a constitutional referendum. The only thing that they demanded was the re-elections of the parliament. So they have suspended the parliamentary elections. They have artificially extended their own term that has ended and expired on October 28. And they have announced the constitutional referendum. The sixth convocation, who do not have neither legitimate power nor moral power to write a constitution to us. So then what we have is the de facto replacement or substitution of the constitution, not amendments, and artificial imposition of the constitution to the people. Because according to the current rules, which is written in Article 114 of our constitution, the drafters cannot amend, they cannot adopt the entirely new text of the constitution. We can only introduce changes. So this is another violation. Third thing, like in November, constitutional assembly was established, and it was again established with fundamental violations. What kind of violations? The constitutional assembly was established by the decree of the acting president Talant Mamutov back then. But according to the Constitution, president, and of course the acting president particularly, does not have the right to initiate the law, moreover, to initiate amendments to the Constitution. This right exclusively belongs to the parliament, to Jogorku Kinges. However, the Constitutional Assembly was established by the decree of the acting president, which means the legitimacy of the Constitutional Assembly is under the huge question mark, and which really disappoints us, the lawyers, that it was full of doctors of law sitting there, professors of the law, knowing the fact that the president do not have the right to call for the constitutional referendum or to establish constitutional assembly, but they've decided to join the constitutional assembly and legitimized all illegal things that were happening back then. So which means the legitimacy of the constitutional chamber is under the huge question mark. They just simply cannot be created by the Jogorku Kinges. And then what we see finally is on March 11th, the sixth convocation of Jogorku Kinges, which has limited legitimacy, no moral power at all, with gross violations and bypassing all the established stages of the legislative process without actually receiving the conclusion of constitutional chamber, without waiting for the conclusion of Venice Commission opinion, and without public discussion. This is the constitutional right that every citizen of the Kyrgyz Republic has. And they were not adopting a simple law. It's the constitution, it's the basic law. And the people were not even given the right and the power to actually discuss the text of the constitution. So with these gross violations, they have adopted the bill on appointment of the referendum on the adoption of the new text of the constitution. So as we can see from the beginning, the legitimacy of the entire drafting process of the Constitution is under huge question mark. This draft does not have any even minimum requirements of legitimacy. And as I have already said, if you want a final product, a legitimate product as the Constitution, it must strictly follow the procedures that are written in the text of the Constitution. Second, the draft text of the Constitution actually contains proposals that are incompatible with generally accepted democratic principles. What do I mean by that? First and foremost, the draft text of the Constitution absolutely lacks an effective system of checks and balances. On the other hand, it contains what I could call like completely atrophied system of checks and balances with a huge advantage in favor of the president. And it is already an axiom, every single constitutional lawyers know that a constitution which does not have an effective system of checks and balances, it will surely create the government, or it can surely lead the country or the citizens to tyranny, oppression, and arbitrary rule. It was a long time have already been warned by the US founding fathers of the US Constitution in their Federalist Papers 51 and 47, that it is important to have the checks and balances integrated in the Constitution. Otherwise, it will lead into tyranny, oppression, and arbitrary rule. And now the worrisome sign of the text is that the text is very packed up or saturated with such vague and populist concepts like rule of people, moral, spiritual, or cultural values. And the emphasis of the drafters of the Constitution on such populistic concepts is built upon on the exploitation and manipulation of the people, of the emotions of the people, rather than on realistic arguments based on rule of law. Another problem is, it's the potential violations of the human rights, particularly freedom of speech and access to information. If you look at Article 10, there is already an integrated system of censorship, which clearly says that certain information or public events can be banned for the purposes of protecting traditional moral values. And it is simply a legal document cannot contain such values, vague values or terms like moral or traditional values. There is also a potential violation of the right to peaceful demonstration. And most importantly, the general limitation clause, which is now written in Article 23, It just simply does not have the list of absolute rights that we have currently in our draft text, in our current text of the Constitution. Then the text itself has fundamental violations of the principles of legality and legal certainty. There are just a lot of things that are not unpacked. It just says that it will later on will be regulated by the law. We still don't know according to which system the next convocation of the parliament will be elected. There are so many vague terms, such as which says like, as the president is the head of state, symbol of unity, guarantor of constitution. Such kind of vague terms, they can create conditions for a systematic tendency of concentration of powers in the hands of the president. So with this all set, we just again can say that Kyrgyzstan, we are just not learning from our previous mistakes. Like the same mistakes have been done by Akayev, by Bakiyev, by Atambayev. And this all led to the fact that currently now Kyrgyz Republic has become the hostage to frequent constitutional changes and amendments. And this particularly does not allow our republic, Kyrgyzstan, to fully establish the rule of law and constitutionalism. And this is precisely the main reason of why do we have this constant coup d'etat. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate that. And I think you've tied a lot of the sort of the questions about the legitimacy to some of the issues that Venera has discussed about sort of the lack of real desire to, of the population to participate in this process. Now, if we could move to Natalia Nikitenko and get her comments as an active politician.
Good time of the day to all participants of the discussion. And definitely, I would fully agree with the previous speakers because the political situation for the constitutional reform is really the indicator, you know, about the expectations of the society. And the real expectations of the society in our country that for almost 30 years passed several revolutions was the protest of people against the, any way of monopolizing the power. And even the October events, actually the initial idea of these events, the protest of people was against the try of the previous president and some political elite to concentrate the power from three political parties in the parliament. So definitely we are hardly learning from our own lessons, but I think one big lesson we learned definitely, the people of the Kyrgyzstan, they really value freedom, democratic values, and I'm sure they will not agree with any limiting, you know, the freedoms and the human rights. And unfortunately, this is what is happening and offering with a new amendment, the new actually constitution that will be offered for referendum in this coming Sunday already. I would agree that I voted against that. I represent the opposition party, and this is my sole position, that the constitution really should be discussed widely with the different stakeholders, group of people throughout the country. That never happened with this constitution. That never happened through the constitutional council, which is really had the strange and I think illegal status. This never happened through the parliament. And there are many doubts about the functions and opportunities on this convocation of the parliament to organize such serious process as constitutional reform. I support the idea, the recommendations of the Venice Commission, where it said that the parliament for this prorogation period, it has limited functions. And the really discussing constitution is going beyond the functions of this convocation of the parliament. Despite all those problems, it was organized with them breaking the law about the regulation of the parliament. And the procedures were broken because definitely there were not necessary period of time, no parliamentary discussion. Just between the first reading and the second and third reading that were actually voted together, there was the period just maybe less than 10 days. And this is illegal according to the current law about the regulation about the parliament. And if we start from breaking the procedures, breaking the laws, how we can be sure in the quality and in the legitimacy of the constitution, and how we can prove that in front of people. Many opponents of that position say that we live in the very difficult situation, economical, political, and we don't need to take care about the procedures. Rather, we should look at the content and the stabilization of political situation as soon as possible. But I believe that if we start break the procedures, break the law, we can never stabilize the political situation. We can just, unfortunately, increase the political crisis with accepting such approaches to the constitution. We'll just, unfortunately, I think, exaggerate the problems that we have now with adoption of this constitution. By the content, definitely there are so many complaints that we say it as an opposition in the parliament, but we were in minority. Actually, there were just six MPs out of 120 total number of MPs who voted against accepting this law about the referendum and gave their comments and concerns about the content. Unfortunately, we were not heard. By the content, definitely one of the major concerns that the norms of law, the human rights, they kind of tend to be replaced by some spiritual things, some not legal terminology. What is the public conscience? What is the spiritual and fundamental traditions? You know, the nation of Kyrgyzstan, the Kyrgyz Republic, is the majority of different stakeholders, different ethnicities, different religious, etc. So the terminology about public conscience is very tricky, and actually it's very subjective. And actually it will lead to the censorship. And I'm afraid it will be the case for our country in future if this constitution will be supported by referendum. The next thing that the president concentrates the total power in his hands. When this topic was discussed in the parliament, one of the representatives, the head of the constitutional council that was formed by very not transparent and not open criteria, he told that we actually learned the experience of many countries, and we, based on the experience of the United States of America, when we developed this draft of the constitution, discussing it in the constitutional council. But actually, this is really very strange and interesting idea that he said, because the Constitution of the United States of America, despite the thing that the president is leading, like the head of the executive power, it has the very strong system of checks and balances, and this is essential. Independent system of court system, independent and strong Congress, strong parliament. This is the key things. And here in the draft constitution that is now presented to the people, actually all this checks and balances system is not really existing at all. There is just the president who actually appoints the head of the constitutional court, the head of the Supreme Court, the general prosecutor. There is a parliament with very limited and weakened functions. No parliamentary control in the constitution, no oversight function of the parliament. Less number of MPs, it's decreased from 120 to 90. Actually, no guarantees for opposition. What we have in current constitution, this is strong guarantees for oppositional parties. And that provides some checks and balances system inside the parliament that actually allows the people to have their representation and voices through the parliament, not through the streets. And here, breaking the system, there is a serious risk that all these people's voices will not be heard through the parliament. Also, there is kind of the try to organize the national kurultai. This is a kind of the second parliament, I would say. But it will not be elected by people. it's offered that this national Kurultai would be appointed probably by the president. So actually, this is separating the functions of the parliament between two institutions, and the Kurultai is getting the right to initiate the law, to provide the offer to the president, to dismiss the head of the cabinet of ministers. Also, there are some other functions that can be described in the legislation about this national Kurultai. Definitely, there will be the conflict between the parliament and artificial parliament in the face of Kurultai, I believe, because it's not clear what kind of relationships should be organized between those two bodies and where is the limit between their functions. Definitely, there are many concerns about the court system. Despite the fact that the constitutional court will be organized, still the system of appointment by the president, the head of the Supreme Court, and who will appoint the heads of the local courts, it definitely makes the system of independence of the system under the big question mark. And this is definitely the serious stress and the serious challenge for check and balances system. Also, there is the role of general prosecutor, which is getting the stronger functions. For example, in the current constitution, the general prosecutor doesn't have the functions to investigate. And the new constitution offers the functions to investigate, and not just on the state and municipal servants, but also for any person, any individual. And we had in our history already the bad examples when general prosecutor's office served the power, and actually that led, together with dependence on other powers, to one personality, one president, that led to the two revolutions in our history. And unfortunately, this lesson we didn't learn properly. And this new constitution offers again the system when president is appointing everyone, is responsible for everything, but he is not accountable to anyone, nor the parliament, nor the people. But I think that in this situation, definitely, people, they don't really realize what is offered within this constitution for their future. Because the recent polls that IRI did, they demonstrated that about 86% of people of our country, they answered that they need more information about the constitution. So they don't really aware what is particularly offered to them for this referendum. And another thing that more than 70% of people, they mentioned that they won't really keep the democratic values, democratic path. And the majority of people also on the answer do agree that the president will be elected for more than one term. Now, by new constitution, it will be two terms. The majority of potential voters, they responded against, negatively. So people, they don't really expect and don't really want the monopolizing of power. And I think those indicators, they demonstrate that there was the lack of information for people, what's going on. And definitely taking into account that people are really tired of all those political changes for the very short historical period. And unfortunately, after 2010, definitely people had so high expectations about parliamentary democracy. And the parliamentary model does have a very good future in the country. But unfortunately, I would agree with the colleagues said before that the political elite didn't use all potential of current constitution, all the potential parliamentary democracy principles. And despite that, the constitution was written very clearly protecting the human rights, the interest of people, the high level of transparency and accountability. The political elite, and namely the previous president, they started to use unconstitutional ways and means to make the parliament silent, to stop the opposition. And I do know that as the member of the opposition party, that the previous president Atambayev did a lot to change the system of checks and balances, even within the current constitution, using not constitutional means and tools, making repressions against opposition and political leaders. So people saw that they are kind of disappointed in that system. Okay. But I think that this disappointment mostly related with the political elite, the particular politicians, and people are tired of that, but not the system. And unfortunately, I think that using this tiredness of people, there was the serious political manipulation with people's understanding. And right now, this approach and this constitution is offered for people, not giving them the full information what's going on, and not even giving the opportunity to people vote article by article. So they will vote for the whole text, against or pro. So I think this is really have serious risks and challenges for our country.
Okay, thank you very much. Appreciate your comments, and I just sort of noted you mentioned how there's discussion about sort of the U.S. and modeling this on the U.S. I think there's only been about 27 successful amendments in the U.S. Constitution over 230 years. So there's a lot. It's a lot more challenging in other countries to sort of change these. Now, if we could bring Ambassador Baisalov in, Ambassador Baisalov, who holds degrees from American University of Central Asia, the Kyrgyz State Normal University. He's a longtime civil activist who has entered governments at various times of the year, and he's currently Kyrgyzstan's ambassador to the United Kingdom. And if you could have a few minutes to give your views and respond, we appreciate it. Thank you. We also have a lot of questions as well, so if we could try to keep everything short from this point on.
Thank you very much, Dr. Stronsky, for this opportunity to participate in today's roundtable. First of all, of course, less than a couple of hours ago, we learned about the sad news about the demise of His Royal Highness Prince Philip. So our deepest condolences to the United Kingdom. Our thoughts are with the royal family. It's a great opportunity for me to speak and to have this chance to be together with this distinguished panel. Of course, Honorable Chairwoman of the Parliamentary Committee, Natalia Nikitenko, one of the most prominent journalists, Venera Jumataeva, and our brilliant young scholar, Dr. Sonia Sagnaeva. It's a very eloquent points that you raise, but I think it was best summed up at the last few minutes by Natalia Vladimirovna when, not one of my fellow speakers today can argue that it is the overwhelming majority of our people today, they are not happy with the state of affairs of Kyrgyzstan. That this constitution did not work, did not deliver. And it is our biggest, greatest disappointment, my personal disappointment as well, that this Kyrgyz dream of building parliamentary democracy, of having this Westminster model work in our country, it was proven that we are not ready for this, right? And indeed, all of our civil activists and democratic press, myself included, we've spent the last 10 years by mocking the parliament. Every day it was a never-ending circus of this parliamentary news and all the incompetence and ineffectiveness. What we knew, it was a false facade of this parliamentary rule by these moneybags and party barons. So I would like to draw everybody's attention and remind that the referendum held on January 10th this year, more than 84% of our people voted, endorsing strongly the presidential system. And President Sadyr Japarov was elected at the same day, widely recognized by the international community as free and fair elections. He received 79% of the vote. So this is what democracy looks like. nothing artificial about it, nothing imposed on this by some people. This is the will of the people, and President Sadyr Japarov is rightfully using his strong mandate to set the political course and build this system in response to the popular demand and he want to improve effectiveness of our state governance. And very shortly, Dr. Stronsky, I would like to just respond to Dr. Sagnaeva when you criticize this illegality and the lack of legitimacy and all these procedural, mostly violations, you say procedures that this parliament did not have any right to do this, and it was short time, and the Constitutional Council did not provide. I will remind you that the current constitution that you keep as a sacred text, I can remind you that it was adopted by the interim government. I was part of the interim government, of course, but I remember very well, the parliament was dismissed, dissolved. There was no Supreme Court, there was no Constitutional Court. And the referendum, the Constitutional Council was criticized that it was closed, and nobody, of course, even then did not vote article by article as Natalia Vladimirovna is suggesting. And the referendum itself took place on June 27, 2010, just, you know, when half of our country was burning, you know, in this inter-ethnic strife. So perhaps it was the fault of the current, of the authors of the current constitution, that it was perhaps, there was lack of political participation and endorsement and legitimacy back then. So I will hopefully have some chance to respond about this supposed lack of checks of balances later. But I can tell you that most what we heard by the today is concerning this procedural points, but the matter of the fact is that in October we had change of regime. The current constitution did not work. All of our critics, including the authors of the constitution, they were jailed. 15 members of parliament under the current constitution were arrested and served prison times. So who are we going to say that this constitution somehow is going to violate parliamentary immunity if the current constitution doesn't defend them? Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. And what I think I'll do is I think I'll put some of the questions out there that we have, because they're coming in. And then I would like all of in answering those questions, I would like the other main three panelists to feel free to respond to the ambassador as well. One of the first questions, and I'm actually going to merge some of these to make it go faster, is what is the impact of the constitutional reform on political parties and on the development of the new election system? And what are the most important next steps if this referendum passes? What are the most important next steps do you see, particularly for our member of parliament, but also for the political parties, and then anyone on civil society? I think it's been very clear that Kyrgyz civil society is not happy with how the country's been governed. What is next for both the parliament as well as the development of parties and the development of civil society? Maybe if we could turn to Natalia Nikitenko, please.
Okay, thank you. First of all, I'd like to mention regarding the current constitution. Despite the really serious problem that half of the country was in the problem in June 2010, the Constitutional Council worked with different stakeholders, and there were wide discussion of the current constitution. And you know that many civil society activists participated in this discussion. If compared to this Constitutional Council that now was formed by a big question, you know, in the system and in the situation when there was no, let's say, contradiction as it was said by the president at that time in the country. So that was on the legal basis. But at the same time, the current constitutional council didn't have any visual intention to involve civil society representatives. And it was just appointed. And this is a significant difference between 2010 in the difficult condition, but it was done, and today. And also, I'd like just to mention that we talk, all of us, about the procedures some part of the time, because indeed this is important when this concerns the constitution as the major document for any state, any country. But actually we pay attention, I particularly, in the content of the constitution, what is offered. And this is really awful situation, where the system is just collapsed. And you will see the results of that, unfortunately. So what is the next step? I think that on the referendum, taking into account the situation, etc., it might have chance to be supported by the people. And even despite the lack of information and political manipulation, etc., if the constitution is accepted on the referendum, there will be really a serious period of time of work for the parliament and civil society and all the civil activists and all the lawyers, because there are so many contradictions inside the constitution and so many chances. For example, the president is not limited by this constitution, just by the constitution. There is a chance to identify the functions of the president by other laws, can you imagine? So it can be whatever. And there are so many contradictions inside that can describe the functions beyond the constitution for Kurultai, the functions beyond this constitution for the president, that can make the situation even worse for the country. So I think that the serious attention from the MPs and all the legal activists, like civil activists, should be concentrated on the work with the major legislation that should be changed according to the new constitution. And this is namely law about the government that should be seriously changed. This will be electoral legislation, because in the autumn there will be the elections of the parliament, and definitely the new rules should be offered and organized. And definitely there is a huge number of legislation that should be actually rewritten, and we should be very careful with that.
Great. And then for civil society, does Sania or Venera, do you have any thoughts about, what this means for civil society moving forward?
Can I first reply to the question of Ambassador Vaisala, if you don't mind? Okay.
Sure.
So unfortunately, I think the argument brought by Ambassador Vaisala really resembles what we know, the tu quoquo, the interim government did it, why can't we do that? And that is the problem with Kyrgyzstan, is that every single constitutional referendum, starting with Akayev, then followed by Bakiyev and the rest, has been done with gross procedural violations. And no one is here making out of 2010 constitution a holy cow. The lawyers, most importantly, they value the rule of law. And we should understand that one of the main root causes of 2005 events was the fact that Akayev have amended the constitution of 1993 four times by abusing his constitutional rights. The main root causes of 2010 events was that because Bakiyev, by abusing his powers, have amended the constitution as well. The root causes of October 2020 events was the illegal constitutional referendum made by Atambayev in 2016. And now the same mistake is being done by Sadyr Japarov and his team. They just don't understand. And the question about previously the violations were made, it is fine to do it again. It's not valid. The most important is actually the rule of law. Kyrgyzstan cannot afford next political turmoil, but the short history demonstrates that the main root causes of all the revolutions are actually constant constitutional amendments. As for the implications for civil society and political parties, one of the questions that mentioned, That is the main problem, is actually the uncertainty that the current constitution contains. It is uncertain by which electoral system the next convocation will be elected. And of course, it is going to have a detrimental effect on political parties, because we still don't know whether we are going to keep party system or not, or whether the majoritarian system will be back. And if they're going to, again, rehabilitate majoritarian system, then we can forget about quotas. We can forget about gender quotas, ethnicity quotas, and the rest, which again would create the next convocation of parliament fully packed by men, without the representation of any representatives from women, from other social groups, and etc. And right. The same, of course, and it will have this backsliding effect on any aspects of the life in Kyrgyzstan. Thank you.
Great. I can give you a second to respond in a moment, but we've got a couple of questions and not a whole lot of time. We have some on journalism. And so I was actually maybe pivot to Venera Jumatayeva. The first is, you know, the Kyrgyz constitution talks about the freedom of expression and freedom of speech. But how do people value those freedoms in Kyrgyzstan? And where do Kyrgyz society, where do voters, you know, how do they view journalism? Is it do they view it as an objective source or more of a subjective source? And if it's the latter, where do people get their information? And then added on to that, you know, there's been a lot of exposés about crime and corruption and the rise of organized crime. You know, OCCRP, RFERL were involved in some of those. What sort of impact are those allegations having on society, but also how people view media, both state media and more independent media?
Yeah, thank you. The press freedom and freedom of expression are one of the main indicators for the Kyrgyz society. Kyrgyz people very, very highly appreciate having this opportunity in their own country to have press, free press, independent press, and to have a possibility to express their opinion. If you look at the numbers, and the internet penetration is very high in Kyrgyzstan. So I was just in Kyrgyzstan, returned like a few days ago. From small children to elders, they all think, they believe that they can express their opinion about everything on internet. You know, that's a big achievement. And I had official meetings also, like with Kyrgyz officials. And as I realize now, hopefully, they understand and they believe that it is impossible to deprive Kyrgyz people of that their big value, you know, as press freedom and independent media. So as even history shows, you know, Radio Azatik is one of the main leading media organizations in Kyrgyzstan, I mean RFRL's Kyrgyz service, and Akayev and Bakiyev, former presidents, they tried to silence Radio Azatik, our service in Kyrgyzstan. And soon after that, they were ousted from their posts, from their offices, you know. And now Kyrgyz people even make jokes. It's better not to have problems with the Radio Azatik if you want to stay longer in your office. So, I mean, Kyrgyz people really, really appreciate the value of independent media. And I have to say that we can be proud of Kyrgyzstan's media, because Radio Azatik is not the only one independent media in Kyrgyzstan. There are more than 10 or around 10 very strong local independent media organizations. And second question about our investigative reports. These investigative reports became one of the main engines for October revolution, let's say, when the former president Jeenbekov had to resign from his office. And so just recently one foreign diplomat told me in Bishkek that he hasn't seen such big impact by one foreign media in one particular country. So he said it's incredible how the Radio Azatik, our RFRL and OCRP and COOP investigative reports made such a huge impact on society. I can say that. Thank you.
Great. So, no, there's a lot of interest, and I actually followed the Kyrgyz media fairly closely because it's a good source, not just for Kyrgyzstan, but for the entire region as well. A couple other questions. We only have about 5 minutes left. And, you know, one, how long do you think this constitution will survive? We've seen other constitutions come and go. Is this, you know, just going to be another part of that cycle? And then maybe the ambassador could also touch on this. I know he was the former social development minister in charge of disabled and elderly, so he's worked with vulnerable populations in the past. And you know, there are some concerns about Kyrgyz morals and traditions, that language that's in there, because there are ethnic minorities in Kyrgyzstan, there are disabled minorities, there are sexual minorities, gender minorities, and sort of. What are the concerns, and how you know, how are universal human rights going to be upheld if this language is there against all these vulnerable communities who have human rights? And if any of the other speakers want to add into that too, I'd be interested in their views.
Thank you very much. First of all, of course, I would like to join in complimenting our free press and brave journalists and. We know how essential they are for our democracy, and I can reassure you that there is no risk for freedom of speech. And I can tell you, on you know, based on my experience as a democratic activist, when back in the 90s or early 2000s, we used to, freedom of speech was a, you know, a dozen newspapers reaching some activists, you know, in back country, and now everyone has smartphone. What risk we are talking about to freedom of speech? And to Dr. Sagnaeva, of course, you're talking as a lawyer should. You're talking about the root causes of the instability and of constitutional changes. And you're saying this is law. I will disagree with you. It is poverty. It is poverty and the failure of state services. Our people are frustrated, especially we saw it during COVID. The failure of the state, you know, while these lawyers and a couple hundred politicians argue about the constitution, the people are not getting services. The state is not about some high constitutional debates. It's about delivering to the people. And in this, our state and this constitution has failed. And about these traditional values and some language, I can assure you that as any state, we are responsible towards our children to defend them. You know, it's that the text from the Constitution that somehow is criticized by our civic activists is copy-paste from Article 5 of the German Constitution. Freedom of speech can be limited in defense of our children. I will tell you, just concluding, elections have consequences. There are some civic activists and there are some lawyers who think they have the veto right, and they can, that without the agreement, nothing can work or nothing should be approved. I can tell you that this is not how democracy works. You go, you win elections, you get supported by the people, and you implement politics. This is okay. What democracy looks like.
Great. Now, I think we've lost Venera, but any of the two speakers have any final thoughts, either in response to the ambassador, or we also have one final question about, you know, how is the region looking at what's going on in Kyrgyzstan? You know, we see a lot of strongman rule countries that don't change their you know, their leaders very often. So any final thoughts either on the questions that were posed to the ambassador or that final question?
If I may, then, sure. You know, I would say that people are disappointed not in the constitution itself as a document, you know, people disappointed by the political elite, which actually is surviving within different constructions of constitution, with the presidential, you know, 19 years of constitution that we have in the country, and parliamentarian, etc. But the parliamentarian model, provided people with opportunity to see what's going on, to make their own opinion. And now I am far from very optimistic expectation about the rising the living of standards of people because of the new constitution, because the roots of the problem are not there. The roots of the problem and the quality of the political elite. And I'm sure that if the political elite that is going to monopolize the whole power is coming with the new constitution in power, and there is no checks and balances system and no transparency, I believe that unfortunately it will not respond to the needs and expectations of people. And they will be disappointed even more. Even right now, already, unfortunately, this political elite doesn't demonstrate any rational and any efficient decisions on economical and social issues, on the issues of borders. And it will be growing when the monopoly of power and lack of checks and balances system will start working. And unfortunately, I think that people in the regions will feel that very soon. And the time life of this constitution will be not very long, unfortunately. This is my personal civil position.
Great. Any final thoughts in just about 30 seconds? It's all we have left, sorry.
So I just wanted to remind that democracy is not the dictatorship of the majority. And we should also be aware of the fact that the turnout for the last referendum was actually less than 50%. It was around 40. And the way how the agitation was happening before the January and now referendum, it cannot be said that it was neutral. So the government now is literally imposing. Back in January, it was imposing the idea of the presidential form. Now it is imposing the idea that this draft constitution is perfect. They're not giving an alternative information in the most public channels. And this is not the way how actually the real free, independent, democratic states function. Thank you.
Great. Do you have a final 10 seconds?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you very much. I enjoyed this conversation a lot, but I would like to reassure everybody on my personal behalf and on behalf of my government that Kyrgyzstan remains committed to democracy. Parliamentary democracy is a big dream. We are going to return to it in 10 years, 15, 20, who knows? But with our levels of poverty at the moment, with so many problems, and exactly, you are right, Natalia Vladimirovna, this current constitution put this the power of the state in the hands of these incompetent elites, thanks to the current constitution. They rose to the top and they abuse the system. Please, I would like to reassure you again, all the democratic commitments of all the international and domestic obligations of the Kyrgyz Republic are going to be remain in place. This is the way we are going to be moving forward. The story of democracy, the light of Kyrgyz experiment and path of our people, of our sovereign people, building nation, building democracy, building. We remain on this road very, very strongly.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. Sure.
We don't have just a second. I don't think that this current constitution brought this political elite, because this political elite and people who are now in power, actually these people who served to Akayev and Bakiev, and this is the same people on the same faces. And it's not about the constitution construction, it's about the understanding the ways, the quality of political elite. And to change that, definitely there need be another approaches rather than changing the construction, then one person will identify the life tomorrow. And I don't think that you can guarantee, as the ambassador of the Kyrgyz Republic on behalf of the whole government and the president, the freedoms that will be saved, because the text of the constitution really has the risks against those freedoms of speech and other human rights and freedoms. So the constitution has this risk, and I don't think that you have the capacity to guarantee that it will be working properly.
Great. Well, I want to thank all four of our speakers. As a friend of Kyrgyzstan, we continue to wish the country the best. We hope that it has political stability and economic stability for the population, and that this will become a reality in the next few years. We'll all be watching what happens this Sunday, and then also there's a lot of interest in what happens after this Sunday and how this this will move forward. So with that, I'd like to thank Venera Jumatayeva, who had to leave us already from RFERL, Dr. Sonia Toktogazieva, the Member of Parliament Natalia Nikitenko, and Ambassador Baisalov. Thank all of you for your comments, for your time, and hopefully we can bring you all back at some point in the next few months. Thank you very much. Wish everybody to stay safe, and thank you for our audience for staying a few minutes late. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.